And this is an introduction to behavioural insights. And over the next 90 minutes, we're going to do a number of things. We're going to meet Max Bazerman, Professor Max Bazerman from Harvard's Behavioural Insights Group, and Dr. Rory Gallagher, who is from BIT's Australia office. And I'm Owain, so I'm the Managing Director of the Behavioural Insights team here in the UK. And the five things that we're going to be learning about, first up, Max is going to talk to us, and he's going to give us a tour of the history of behavioural insights. He's going to talk for 20 minutes about the last 60 years of behavioural insights research and wrap it all together. So you'll go away from this session knowing everything that there is to know about the history of behavioural insights. I'm going to then spend a few minutes talking about how to run a behavioural insights team project along the lines of our sort of core methodology. And then you're going to get an introduction to the simple framework for practitioners that we've developed, the EAST framework. And that was the framework that Robert Cialdini, in his talk, he mentioned. We're going to run through that, and we're going to focus, Rory and I, on loads and loads of different examples from practical applications of behavioural insights in the UK and increasingly overseas. We're then going to put it into practice with an organ donation test of the audience. We were going to do that, but Robert Cialdini just revealed the results. So it will become a comprehension exercise. How much of Robert's talk did you take on board? And then we're going to put it all into practice with a world-exclusive brainstorming exercise using some cards that we've developed that you yourselves are going to get back on tomorrow. So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to Max.
Thank you. Okay. This is my favorite new slide. So before we get to history, let me give you your problem to solve. Whether you like it or not, you're now an investment advisor. You have a client, moderate risk propensity, long-term investment perspective, and wants you to pick a investment fund to invest a bunch of her money. Okay. And I apologize for the Americanization, but this is the S&P 500 or the US stock market over the last 9 years. That's the blue line. You're not going to be able to pick the S&P 500 even if you're an indexing fan, because she came to you for unique advice. Your job, and everyone in the room has to pick one of these funds, is whether you are going to recommend the Green Tobacco Trade Fund, the Rust Alpha Fund, the Purple Fortitude Fund, or the Yellow Alpha Power Trade Investment Fund. So those are your four options, and I'll ask you to spend the next 12 seconds making up your mind, because you need to vote for one of the four. How many of you are going with the Tobacco Trade Fund, the green one? Nobody bold in the audience. Oh, we got one. Okay, excellent. Okay. Anyone for Alpha? Okay, couple for Alpha. How many of you are going with this Purple Fortitude Fund? Okay, and how about Alpha? Power Trade, the yellow one. All right, so we got it looks to me like about 80% for Fortitude, 15% for Power Trade, and 5% for the others would be my quick arithmetic. Does that seem about right? Okay, now my next question to you, is there something wrong with one of these funds? Anybody see a problem? Fortitude is what's the problem with Fortitude? It's too constant. Isn't that good? You got good above market returns with no volatility.
Anomaly.
What's that?
It's an anomaly.
You know, you're being polite. Yeah, yeah.
But these are historical.
Yeah, I'm just.
There are no predictions of the future whatsoever.
No prediction of the future, so passive and predictive. But she's saying anomaly anyhow. Okay. How many of you have a background in economics or finance? Right? And for those of you with a background in economics or finance, is it possible to consistently outperform the market with absolutely no volatility? Okay. Most of you invested your money in Bernie Madoff's Ponzi scheme. Okay. Now, many of you are going to complain that I only gave you 30 seconds to make a decision and you didn't claim expertise in finance. But what I want to highlight is that there are lots of people who had expertise, who had years to notice, who didn't notice that something was wrong. and this was shockingly noticeable, and I would argue it was a job of lots of people to notice that fortitude was not a possibility, and there was fraud going on to create that. Now, most of you are not in the business of fraud detection.
I'm gonna try to get rid of this. Okay. I can yell out, so I'm just gonna put this over here.
But what I wanna argue is that to be effective in the behavioral insights world requires it for you to notice things. The opportunities in the noticing world come from seeing opportunities about things that aren't right. And so often, we have lots of hints. We know it's not operating the way it's supposed to. We think it should operate better, but we kind of accept that that's the way the world is. And I think that successful behavioral insight implementation requires noticing that there's greater opportunities out there. Now, my fellow speakers on this panel are 35 and 36 years old, and that's how long I've been teaching this stuff. Okay. So I took my first teaching position in 79, and this has been just kind of a fascinating journey to watch. And I want to give you a little bit of perspective to tell you what I think is so special about the current era that we're in and what's going on. So for me, this field dates back, and different people would date in different ways, but I date this field to Herb Simon's notion of bounded rationality. He's the first person who kind of clearly specified that humans aren't rational decision makers and introduced the concept of bounded rationality. But it was really Kahneman and Tversky's 1974 paper that talked about the systematic and predictable ways in which humans deviate from rationality. Okay? But even with this amazing paper that got the field thinking about what are the systematic and predictable mistakes that people make that we might be able to fix, okay? And we'll come back to fixing them in a minute, this really did not set off the debate with economists to produce the field of behavioral economics. Rather, that occurred with Kahneman and Tversky's 1979 paper on prospect theory. And the most important piece of this, I believe, for creating the field of behavioral economics is this problem, which I think is the most famous problem in the history of the social sciences, where people are asked to think about this problem where the US is about to get hit by an unusual disease, and you have to either pick between saving 200 people or a 1/3 chance of saving 600, and most people save the 200 for sure, unless you're asked about how many people will die, and you ask the same problem by focusing on the losses instead of the gains, and you get a complete reversal of opinion, where Kahneman and Tversky showed that the framing of risky problems could dramatically alter people's preferences. Now, the reason I call this the most important problem, it's not that that framing is the biggest issue in the real world, but this problem created the first evidence that economists couldn't refute. And this really created the dialogue that's created the modern field of behavioral economics. Okay, now, this led to the proliferation in lots of other fields. I've done a whole bunch of work in negotiations, but we saw a proliferation across these fields and others as this topic took hold. And basically, professional schools adopted this idea with the notion that if we can identify how humans are less than perfect decision makers, we can then fix them. Okay? And this is represented very nicely in a 1982 paper by Baruch Fischhoff called Debiasing. And what I want to emphasize about this work, and the reason I told you how old I am and how, well, at least how long I've been teaching, I'm 60 years old, but the reason I wanted to tell you how long I've been teaching it is that I can tell you that as some of us became enthusiastic fans of the Kahneman and Tversky world, we clearly had the notion if we knew what was wrong with human judgment, we could fix intuition. Okay? What Fischhoff argued in as early as 1982 is that our ability to fix human intuition is dramatically limited. Okay? So it turns out that this was a field that was great at noticing what was wrong, was completely and totally inept at fixing human intuition, which was clearly what the goal of the field was all about from a prescriptive standpoint as of 1980. The problem was we didn't know what else to do, so we kept on trying. So W.C. Fields said, if at first you don't succeed, try again, then quit. No use being a damn fool about it. But since we didn't have anything else to do, we kept on trying. Okay. But Fischhoff ended up being right. To this day, we're pretty lousy at fixing human intuition. In the last small number of years, since the new millennium, we've seen two critical directions about what to do with this amazing field. One is to get people out of system one thinking into system two thinking. So the system one, system two distinction is by Stanovich and West, made popular by Danny Kahneman's book, Thinking Fast and Slow. But there's lots of dual process theories that look something like this. But the basic idea is that we lead most of our lives using our intuitive processes. And you have books like Malcolm Gladwell's Blink to encourage you to use your intuitive processes. By the way, I consider that to be the worst book written in the history of the world. So not only is it so wrong, but it's written so well you'll remember it for the rest of your life. And professionals love the message, trust your intuition, despite the fact that the evidence suggests that you should be quite skeptical of your intuition. The idea of system one, system two is that we have all kinds of system two processes that allow us to improve our decision making. Thinking more systematically, using analysis in a systematic way, talking to people who know more than we do, using their group to help us think through this decision. All of these are system two processes, but most of our decisions are made by system one, and that's probably pretty good, because if you go to a grocery store and you make every decision in system two, it'll take you a week and a half to get through the store. Okay? So we want to use system one for lots of routine, unimportant decisions. The problem is we also use system one and trust it for important decisions. And that's when we need to figure out how to prompt ourselves out of system one into system two thinking. And this idea, made popular by Kahneman's book, is really one great solution of what we can do at an individual or a group or a managerial level. So I think that this is an amazing direction. But the other direction, which is closer to the core of today, comes from the book Nudge, which you've already heard about and many of you already know about. If you haven't already read Thinking Fast and Slow and Nudge, and you're going to work in this world, you should read both of these books, and you should also read the next book we'll talk about in just a few minutes. Nudge basically says, if we can't fix human intuition, how can we understand it and then create the choice architecture to lead people to wiser decisions despite their intuition? And this has really become a manual for leaders who want to guide people to wiser decisions. Now, I'm the co-director of something called the Center for Public Leadership at the Harvard Kennedy School. And we have a bunch of people who are experts in leadership. And when the Behavioural Insights Group got started, one of the things I've heard is, how can this possibly be about leadership? When leadership has to do with changing people's hearts and minds. And if you think about nudging, you kind of skip hearts and minds and you just change your behavior. And what I want to suggest is, if you wanted to be an effective leader, you need all the tools you can get to effectively drive behavior. And what we're finding in lots of domains is that nudging may skip hearts and minds and go from architecture to behavior, but in many cases it's creating change at a level that those of us who have worked at the level of hearts and minds were never able to achieve. So nudging has had a profound influence on the creation of a variety of real-world changes. And the Behavioural Insights team, and Rory and Owain are both the core members of that. The Behavioural Insights team has been the most successful group at driving this change. They've become a role model for Behavioural Insights teams throughout the rest of the world. And when my colleagues at Harvard have an idea that they think is relevant for real-world testing, going to London and working with Behavioural Insights teams is one of the first thoughts that they're going to have, because these folks know a fair amount about implementation that they're going to be telling you a little bit about as soon as I quit talking. All right. Now I want to show you one other thing, because what I'm suggesting is that we need to notice opportunities of what's wrong and fix it. Okay? And then we want to devise strategies for how would we go about implementing, and that's what Owain and Rory will be talking about. But before I turn it over to them, academics like talking about the emotions in research, so I'm going to do that. And I want to tell you about my conceptually most trivial research of my life. Okay, I thought that that's what you'd want to hear. But what is the most conceptually trivial work of my life? And in the U.S., before you appear in a court of law, you say, I'm about to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth. And then you testify. And more commonly in life, we fill out forms, and then we sign it and say, I told you the truth. Okay. Now, there's a couple of things that just changed. One was oral, one was written. One was before, and one was after. So I don't want that confound. So I want you to imagine you're filling out a form. And I want you to imagine that people are filling out a form, and some people sometimes lie a little bit, perhaps to save money on their taxes. Here's a quick thought question for you. What makes more sense if you want to improve people's honesty? To have them fill out the form and then sign it saying, I told you the truth? Or would it make more sense to first have people sign, I'm about to tell you the truth, and then fill out the form? All right. So we'll skip to hand raising in the interest of saving time, but I can tell you that somewhere between 99 and 100% of the executives that I ask that question to, even without the hints on the right, get my question right. Okay? And we now know it to be empirically true. If people sign before they report the data, they have greater honesty than if they first fill out a form and then sign it. Now, this is really boring. I already proved that it was boring by asking you which will work better, and everybody knows the answer to this. But the amazing part about this is that we got it wrong for so many decades. Our signature was in the wrong place. And what I want to suggest to you is that there's lots of things that we institutionalize, and we got wrong for many, many years. And the notion that the market would get us to the right answer not only isn't right in government, it's probably not right in corporations. Okay? The market doesn't drive us there. There's a lot of things we just do wrong. So we want to notice opportunities and then figure out how do we implement and test change. And that's what Owain and Rory will be talking about for the rest of the session.
Thank you, Max. And I'm sure that you won't mind me saying that another must-read book in this field is Max's own book, The Power of Noticing, which is available in the bookshop downstairs, and which I'm sure he'd be happy to sign a copy of.
So that's very nice, but I was actually meaning when I got to the Behavioural Insights slide to basically say, you need Halpern's book. I'm inside that lecture. And that was the third book I was going to mention, not my own, but thank you.
And this is illustrating another nice point, which is about reciprocation. I say something nice to Max, and he reciprocates. Right, so I'm going to now just spend a few minutes telling you about how to run a Behavioural Insights team style project. And this is the kind of boring stuff, but it's also the stuff that makes everything else work. Like Max says, what we have become expert in within the Behavioural Insights team is applying some of the ideas that people like Max and his colleagues have generated in academia and applying them in practice to government processes and systems. And if you're going to do that, you need to have a bit of project methodology around the way that you work, because I think there's a bit of a tendency to assume that in this field, you can go, generate lots and lots of ideas, and then the magic will happen. And unfortunately, it doesn't work like that. So you'll need to spend a few minutes listening to this before we get on to the fun stuff. And we've developed, as you'll come to learn if you read a bit more about the behavioural science team, a special mnemonic, which is basically what we do most of the time. We develop mnemonics to help you remember ideas and concepts. And this is one of them, T-E-S-T, test, the mnemonic for how to run a behavioural insight team project. So the first thing is that before you even start thinking about what you might do, you need to think about what your objective is, right? And I say this in the full knowledge that everybody who's ever worked in government will say, well, this is what we always do all the time. You know, we're always focused on an objective. But I think we find, as practitioners in the field, that it is worth spending an awful lot of time just clarifying exactly what it is that you're trying to achieve. And I'm thinking that, and often you will realize that what you think you're trying to achieve is not what the people that you're working with think that you're trying to achieve. So I'll give you a couple of examples. Done a lot of work on energy efficiency, have a discussion with the Department of Energy and Climate Change around a piece of work that we're doing to help people to make their homes more energy efficient. We think that the idea is to save them money. The people in the Department of Energy and Climate Change think that the idea is to save money, but their colleagues think that the idea is to help those in fuel poverty to save money. And that leads you in different directions. It changes the focus of your project. Another group in the same department think that actually the idea is not to help people to save money, but to ensure that those within what's known as fuel poverty heat their homes and keep themselves warm. That actually leads you in literally the opposite direction. Keeping your home warm results in you using more energy, not less, and potentially spending more money. And their focus is on the health benefits of that same program. So being really, really clear about what your objective is a must before you even begin. Being able to quantify that, being able to specify over what time period, being able to say who it is that an intervention is going to be run in relation to is critical. And when Rory and I come to talking about specific interventions, you'll see exactly what I mean by that. The second, I think, underutilized, underexplored area of what we do, we call the explore phase. So the E of test is explore. And this is just another way of saying that we need to try and spend time trying to understand what it feels like for the people using government services, what it feels like for them, how they're going to relate to the services that we're putting into practice. A lot of this thinking comes from fields like design thinking, user-centered design. One of the twists that we often apply is that it's not just about the end user, it's not just about user-centered design. It's also about the person who's administering the service as well. So some of the programs and the projects that we're going to talk about are in, for example, job centers, where it's as much about the person who is helping the person looking for work as it is about that end user themselves. And we call this the explore phase because it's all about understanding what it feels like to use that service, but understanding what it feels like for the end user as well as the person administering that service. So that's the U of test. The solution development is what we're going to get into in a second. Using, drawing on behavioral insights, drawing on the history, wealth of behavioral science research in order to develop our ideas and then ultimately to put them into practice. And we'd like to emphasize that this is an iterative process. So you don't just say, let's set our target, let's do some exploring, let's develop our solution. You have to always be able to iterate around these three things. So you might start developing a solution and then realizing that actually in practice, it's not going to be feasible to put this brilliant new idea you've had out into practice. So you need to iterate between these things. It might be that that also makes you reassess exactly what the objective of a different project is. So the solution phase needs to be taken forward in relation to what it is that you're trying to achieve and what you're learning from the field and the experiences that you're taking on board. Once you've done that, and only once you've done that, you can start moving to our fourth, and in some respects, our most important phase, which is trying to understand whether or not the intervention actually works in practice. And at this morning's sessions, you'll have heard a lot about testing and trialing. And in the behavioural insights team, we often say that there are basically two things that we do. There's these first three things, developing solutions, drawing on ideas from the behavioural sciences, and there's a second batch of things, which is testing and trialing those ideas in practice to see whether or not they work. What we're really interested in is what works. And the way that we do that is we run, where possible, large-scale randomized evaluations. We're effectively starting to treat and think about policy interventions in the same way as we would think about a new medicine or a clinical process. The way that we do that is by taking a group of people. So imagine these are job seekers. These are people out of work, and you've got a new job seeking program that you're about to put in place. Imagine that each of these stakeholders represents 1,000 people. Rather than rolling out your whole intervention across the whole country, you divide that group of people into two. You give one of them, let's say the group on the left, the old way of doing things. You just keep that the same. That's your control. That's your equivalent of a placebo, a sugar pill. And you give the other group, you give the new group a new practice, a new way of doing things. And then you see what difference it makes. And in this case, the group on the right is more likely to turn grey, which is our way of saying they're more likely to find work. So what we're going to do now is we're going to take you through our EASE framework in relation to lots and lots of findings from these randomised evaluations that we have run, which I think really, really brings everything to life. So, EASE. Another mnemonic. It stands for, if you want somebody to do something, think about how you can make it easy. Richard Taylor spoke about this before. It becomes a sort of mantra of the team, make it easy. Think about how you can make it attractive, draw attention to the information which is most relevant, social and timely. And we'll go through each of these in turn. Easy. So I always say that if there is one thing that you're going to do to improve the performance of your services, to make people more likely to comply with the systems and the processes that you're putting in place, just start by thinking about how you can make it easy for them. You can do that in lots of different ways. You can simplify those processes, you can remove the bits of friction in the process that prevent somebody from doing something, or you can do this first thing, which has already been spoken about a bit today, switch to default. And this is maybe one of the best examples of this that has been introduced in the UK by our Department for Work and Pensions, helping millions of people to save money for their retirements. And the simple insight was that in the past, we were assuming that people would search the market and would choose the best pension system for them. And from October 2012, we switched the default, and we effectively started to automatically roll people onto pension schemes, giving them the option to opt out. And these are the effects. These are actually the latest findings from the largest employers and medium-sized employers. The whole process is being rolled out first to large, then medium, and ultimately to smaller employers. This is before auto-enrollment. 61% of people in large firms, 44% of people in medium firms had a pension scheme. After automatic enrollment, you go up to about 80%. These are huge effects. You get about 22 percentage point increase for large firms, 32 percentage point for medium firms. This is literally helping millions of people to save for retirement. This is what it's doing at a national level. That's the point at which automatic enrollment is introduced. You get this big uplift. We will see that graph going up again over the next couple of years as more firms come in. And the interesting thing is that not that many people are opting out. It's actually in line with what we would expect from the literature. 9 to 10% of people opt out. And the opt-out rates are even lower for young people, which is what we really want. Yeah? Compound interest over time is incredibly effective. 5.5 million people automatically enrolled so far. We're expecting about 8 to 9 million people overall over the next few years. So people often say, are you looking at small bits of process that you can incrementally improve? Yes, we are. We're interested in that. But sometimes you can change things in what seems like a relatively small way that has a huge effect. So it's all about making it easy. Another great example of how to make it easy is from some work that we've been doing with a guy called Dom King, who's at this conference from Imperial. He's a clinician. And he noticed that when clinicians were prescribing medicines, they often made errors in the charts that they're supposed to fill in to say what they have prescribed the patients that they are helping. And he just made a few simple changes to the form to help encourage clinicians to do the right thing. And it's based on that insight, how do you make it easy for somebody to do the right thing? And this is a section from one of his new charts. And there are just a couple of things I'll point out. One of them is this. You can see that you might not be able to see microgram, milligram, gram, units, other. The main insight was that in the old form, you were expecting doctors to have to write out in longhand all of these things. In the new form, you just circle the dosage that you need to administer. He was finding that on the 7,000 forms that he reviewed to start this study, about 7% of them had an error of one kind or another. And one of those common mistakes was that the doctor would write something that kind of looked a little bit like microgram, but it could have been milligram. And as those of you who have some kind of background in health know, that can be quite a consequential change. So he redesigned forms around these principles, drawing on the East framework and its predecessor, Mindspace, and effectively eliminated errors in whole swathes of cases. So the doses are now being entered correctly in about 100% of cases. You get small details like in the old forms, the prescriber's contact number was often entered incorrectly, no longer the case. And the frequency of medications entered correctly is gone up by an order of magnitude. So these things can have, in some areas, you can do something that seems like it's relatively small, but it can have, again, quite big consequences. So that's easy. Onto attractive, the second principle of these framework, and probably the one that is mistaken most frequently. Attractive is all about drawing our attention to the bits of process, the form, the letter, the bits of information which are most important for the individual to recognize and to respond to. It's also about personalization. Robert Cialdini spoke a lot about this in his session. We respond to things, we are more likely to respond to things that feel like they are directed at us personally. And it's about rewards and incentives, but understanding how these take place and are made manifest from a behavioral perspective is not just saying, give somebody some money to do something you want them to do. Much more nuanced than that. And I'll give you again a couple of examples before I hand over to Rory. This is one of my favorite examples just because it's large scale, but it's basically cost free and has a pretty big impact. And it's all about drawing attention to small and medium businesses in a way that was never done before. So we have a lot of work that we do with our tax authority, with HMRC in the UK, and we noticed that they were routinely sending out missives to small businesses about their tax affairs. So, dear Rory, you own a particular business, you need to fill in your tax form this year. And all of the messages were about tax. And our sort of sense was that you could draw on this sort of notion of reciprocity by drawing the individual's attention to relevant information about forthcoming government schemes, but that there were potentially different ways in which you might do that. And one of the things that we often say is that we need to act with a degree of humility about how we run programs, because what works in one context may not work in another. So it is worth, this is the other side of testing and trialing, it is worth testing variations and iterations of different ideas to see which one works best. So as per the sort of traditional behavioural insight team methodology, we're sending out hundreds of thousands of emails to companies who might benefit from government programs, but we're testing different messages to see which one works best. And here are the different messages. This is the control. We wanted to see whether a kind of time-limited message might be more effective. The research suggested it would be. And this message is exactly the same, but it just contains this line: the vouchers are available for this financial year, so don't miss out. We test that against another message, which is, again, pretty much exactly the same, but with a focus on the fact that the company themselves have been chosen to receive these emails. You have been chosen to receive information about the scheme, as we think you might be eligible for it. Another message draws on what Roy's going to talk about in a minute, which is around the sort of social aspects of these programs. Thousands of businesses are applying for growth vouchers, it says. And that's something that seems to have worked in lots of different areas. And then the last just draws attention to the incentive. Growth vouchers offer up to £2,000 from government to have a half course of getting professional advice in your business. And there's good reason for thinking that each of these messages could work, but no, we need to see and understand which one works best. But before I show you the results, something interesting. This is a program which had relatively low levels of take-up. The spikes in the diagram I'm about to show you are the points at which we send out the emails. You get these huge bounces in click-throughs to the websites and ultimately applications for these programs on the basis of these email shots which are going out to 400,000 firms at any given point in time. And here are the results. Again, you get small changes, but those small things across these big populations start to add up in terms of incremental improvements to the way that we do things. Drawing attention to the money has an effect, but it's not huge. The social norm in this context doesn't seem to work that effectively. Time-limited messages seem to work a bit better. The one that works the best is telling people that they have been chosen to receive this program. And that's the one that we will now use for all of our future programs. We'll iterate on that and try and incrementally improve that message over time. Last one from me, and then I'm going to hand over to Rory. And this is some research that we're going to be publishing in the next couple of weeks with the Department of Health and Public Health England. And it's around a simple idea for getting people to turn up to their appointments on time. And we found that in lots and lots of different areas, and in fact, Max and I were just talking to Jeremy Hayward, the head of the civil service, about this very fact that text messaging is an incredibly effective form of communication. And we've been trying these out in lots and lots of different areas, including trying to get people to turn up to their hospital appointments. And it's this really simple idea: draw attention to information which is relevant at a particular moment in time. Another thing that Rory is going to be talking about in a minute. So lots of people fail to turn up to their hospital appointments. We routinely send out these generic text messages to people. But what we want to know is whether we can make them more effective. And the best way of doing that in a UK hospital situation. So this is the control. The appointment at Mile End Hospital gives the date and tells you how to rearrange that appointment if you need to. Our inclination was that just giving people the telephone number would help. Otherwise, exactly the same. We introduced the social norm. Again, Rory's going to talk a bit about this in a minute. 9 out of 10 people attend. And then the final message is this simple one: not attending costs the NHS £160. And our sense was that in a UK context where we have a National Health Service, that people would respond to this message because of the effect that it has on other users of the system and the system as a whole. In this case, the lower number is better. It's about missed appointments. Adding the phone number helps, but it seems to just help people to get to the point slightly quicker. Social norms doesn't help that much more. The one that seems to have the biggest impact is just telling people what the cost to the National Health Service might be. In this particular site, rolling this out would save about 5,800 missed appointments. You can see that across the whole of England, as we're hoping to be able to do in a couple of weeks' time when we publish the research. 400,000 missed appointments would be saved. So I'm going to hand over to Rory now to talk about social before we both come back for our amazing, world-famous live brainstorming session. Here's you, Rory.
Thanks for that. As Owain's sort of highlighted and alluded, I've had the opportunity over the last 3 years now to be based overseas and to try some of these interventions based in Sydney, in Australia, and in Singapore. And the great thing about that last trial is you've actually been able to replicate that in Australia with almost exactly the same effect size. Because some of these questions have been, is this just unique to the British cultural or political system? And it's quite often hard to replicate exactly because we have different systems or letters of communication. This one we can use almost exactly the same text. And in this case, framing it around, you know, the losses to the health system or gains to the patient, again, had a very similar effect size and was the most effective message. So what's really interesting, we're beginning to see how these things can transfer across national boundaries as well. As I said, I'm just going to talk through social. Now, Bob Cialdini spent most of his talk talking about how we're heavily influenced by the behaviour of others. So I won't really talk about the theory at all, but essentially he highlighted that we are all social beings. And that the behaviour of others heavily influences our own. And what's really interesting, and David alluded this into his talk this morning, is that we actually systematically underestimate the good behaviour of others and often overestimate the bad behaviour of others. So actually, if you can just try and help to realign that, what people's perceptions are with realities, you can actually boost outcome. So the reason we sort of, you probably may have heard this alluded to again in David's talk earlier on. Early on, when we were sort of trying to prove the case for these types of approaches, we went to areas where we could measure and monetize results, partly because of the sort of political and fiscal situation we were in at the time, and we were trying to understand, could we use these approaches to encourage people to pay their taxes? And there was a tax official called Nick Downs, who was very innocent, and he was influenced, actually, by Bob's Cialdini's work, and he set about thinking about, could we apply this to some of our own letters? And he seemed to get a good response. So since that point, we've worked with the tax office and Nick and some of the other teams and taken that to scale and tested in a more robust way through RCTs the effects of these different types of messages. But it all really stemmed from this idea of, actually most people think they underestimate the pro-social behaviour, that most people are paying their tax on time. And we've used that principle in many, many tax trials since. So this is sort of one of the subsequent trials, and this was for people's self-assessment tax debts, and sending out the sort of standard letter, around a third of people paying. When you just highlighted that 9 out of 10 people pay their tax on time, we got a bit of a bump. When in fact we said the vast majority of people in your local area pay their tax on time, we got even more of a bump. When we highlighted that most people with a debt like yours pay their tax on time, we got another bump. And when you added those things together, you got an even bigger increase. And this is interesting also because of the additive sort of nature of it. In some areas we've seen that when you add two types of effects, and sometimes even backfire, or you get no additional effects. In this one, you actually got an additional bump. And as Owen's always sort of alluded to, these sort of percentage point increases, actually when you're dealing with these sorts of numbers, they are tens of millions, if not hundreds of millions of extra revenue being brought forward. So really quite consequential. And this is the sort of recent exciting developments in the field as well, as our sort of data systems get better, our trial designs get neater, we're able to do things like subgroup analysis to understand not only how does this work at a population level, but for who. And actually you can see here, the particular groups, particular messages seem to work very well. So for the most wealthy, the top 1%, you can see actually that highlighting that they're not paying tax influences whether the delivery of public services, so paying for schools, roads, hospitals, actually have a much bigger effect than on the rest of the population. And again, you can sort of think intuitively why that might be. You know, these people with very large amounts that they owe, they can see how that will translate into paying nurses and teachers' salaries in a way that for those with much smaller tax debts, maybe that sort of message resonates less because the amount is much less. On the flip side, say most people that they are part of a small minority that hasn't paid seems to be very effective, but for the most wealthy, that actually seems to backfire. So we're actually getting now a much more nuanced understanding of what types of messages work for different groups of people. And presumably, over the next few years, we'll see increasing targeted messaging. I mean, it seems incredibly unlikely to us that in 5 years from now, we'll be sending the same letter to everyone. We'll be segmenting our audience as a government and sending different messages depending on people's behavioural characteristics. The final one before we move into the next session is timing. Okay, and Max has already given a great example there with the tax form and the signature that actually prompted people at the right time and asked the right person or the right place in the form is incredibly important. And David, indeed, this morning also talked about the police recruitment trial, giving applicants to the police recruitment process, asking them a specific question at the right moment had a tremendous impact. And again, you can think about this in terms of your own life. In government, we often sort of use our traditional channels rather than thinking through what is the best time to reach someone and what's the best way to do that. So if you want someone to fit energy-efficient devices in a room, loft insulation, the best time to do that is when someone's already having renovations or they're moving house. There's a window of opportunity there that allows you to have much more of an impact than you would at other times. So again, we've used this in lots of areas. And again, this is just like the antimicrobial resistance, a sort of a recent result that's hot off the press around education. Okay, and both myself and Owain worked in the education department in the UK. We spent a lot of time and energy talking about parental engagement. We know how important that is in terms of kids' outcomes. But it's really easy to talk about it in theory and really difficult to do in practice. And actually what we decided to do, so actually one of Max's colleagues, Todd Rogers, had done some great trials in the US which indicated that this could be effective, that texting parents about their kids' attendance or when a test coming up, or about the content of what they're learning, could be a really effective way of getting parents to engage their kids. So for those of you that have got teenage kids, or for those of you who can cast your mind back to being a teenager, you may recognize this scenario. He comes home from school, how was your day? A slight shrug of the shoulders. Have you got any homework? Yeah, don't worry about it. Okay, you can sort of recognize it's quite difficult for the parents to engage and have a conversation. If they just have an additional bit of information at the sort of timely moment, it allows that conversation to happen. So if you're a parent, Raj has a test on Friday, please remind him to study and help him in any other way that you can. They run this test across the sort of west of England, and we've seen, again, incredibly encouraging results. So this has had a significant impact, about the equivalent of a month of extra schooling for these kids that received that text message. Their parents received that text message. And really interestingly, an even bigger impact for the bottom ability quartile. So actually helping us to reach those that arguably we need to reach most. And potentially even more interestingly, they were the most likely to say that they would want these text messages to continue. They actually, you know, before the test, they thought, I don't want you texting my parents. Actually, when we test them after, they actually enjoyed that interaction and support that undoubtedly went around. So sending the right message at the right time can be incredibly powerful. And the last one on timing, we've already heard Bob talk about the sort of need for sort of charitable gifts and how we can influence that. Again, there was a big drive in the UK around legacy giving, so people giving money in their wills. Now, again, we sort of alluded to, the government could try doing campaigns and encouraging you all to save in your wills, but for most of you, it won't be effective. Because most of you, you won't be writing them in that moment, the next hour, the next day, probably not for the next decade. So the most effective way of encouraging people to do that is when they're already writing their will. And actually in government, we need to be more creative about being how we reach them, actually working with the private sector and partners. In this case, we ran a trial with solicitors who were sitting with people who were writing wills. And in the control condition, they didn't ask any question, they just went through the process as normal. Around 5% of people left money to charity in their will. If the solicitors just asked a question, would you like to leave money in your charity? Would you like to leave money for charity in your will? That doubled. And if they just asked one additional question and said, are there any causes that you feel passionate about? And pause and let the person think about that. And then said, would you like to leave any money in your will? It actually trebled. Okay? Really significant increase. And what's also really important is, Owain talked earlier about different outcome measures. Is not only for those people who were asked about causes that they felt passionate about, not only were they more likely to donate, they actually donated more as well. And potentially even more interestingly, some of the subgroup analysis have been to tell us that this is actually most effective for parents and people with no kids. So you can think about going forward who you might want to sort of target. So we're beginning to see the evolutions of these trials, which are telling us outcome measures and different types of messages work for different people at different times. But hopefully that quick run-through has given you a sense of the type of areas that you can focus on and how you might use that framework. If you want someone to do something, make it easy, attractive, social, and timely. And just sort of bring it all together again, when we design an intervention, we don't say, right, okay, this one we're going to apply social, or this time we're going to apply attractive. We actually often use the insights that sit beneath that framework and apply them together. So the final example is some work that we did with Department for Work and Pensions and job centres, trying to help people get back to work. And we started, as Owain alluded to, by really spending some time, weeks, in a job centre, understanding how that process worked from both the frontline staff and the end user's perspective. This is Amy on the left, who was the job centre manager, and we sort of co-designed this set of interventions with the local staff. And they sort of included a sort of bundle of interventions, but one of them was simply to cut down the bureaucracy and the process so that we could give a more personalised service. When you first went into a job centre, this picture here was the amount of forms that you spent signing in your first meeting, including, brilliantly, one piece of paper and a sort of leaflet that you signed and then put the other forms and signatures inside. And we thought that's probably not the best way to spend your first meeting and conversation. We redesigned that process, slimmed down the forms, so that that first conversation was getting to know the person, what they wanted to achieve, their background, their sort of story, and the type of jobs that they were looking for. So, you know, cutting down process can seem quite trivial, but actually it can free up very precious time in public services to actually provide a much more personal service, which is much more impactful. And secondly, we also focused on the social and timely element by introducing these commitment devices and implementation intentions. So rather than asking people to write down what they had done to look for work and then using that as a form of compliance to see whether they get their unemployment benefit, we asked them to write down prospectively what they were going to do over the next week. and very, very specifically. So on Tuesday morning, after walking the dog, I'm going to go to Lawson town centre, and I will look for retail jobs by speaking to three employers on the high street. What we found was, when making these sorts of specific commitments, they were much more likely to follow through on that. And indeed, we saw a significant increase in people leaving benefits and finding work. So once we sort of controlled for all other variables and sort of kicked the tires on the analysis, a 5% point increase in people leaving benefits and finding work. The next challenge was to think through, as sort of Owain's alluded to, once something worked, was how do we now take this to scale? So we ran what's called a sort of step wage trial or a phased-in trial in the County of Essex to work out if these effects persisted over time and between different job centres. And we also developed a train-the-trainer model so that we could spread this across the country. So that started off in the northeast, and through that train-the-trainer model, we've now trained around 25,000 workers and job centres in these techniques, and it's been applied across the country. What's also been incredibly interesting, we've now replicated and adapted these types of approaches in both Singapore and Australia. So in Singapore, we've worked with the Ministry of Manpower, some colleagues are here today, to apply that to their career centres, and again, twisted it to the local context. So we, in this case, used some incentives to encourage people to set up, and changed the environment and the rooms in which these conversations were even happening. And in Australia, we actually applied it to the return to work process after people have been injured, and focused on getting people to think about what they could do to help them in their own medical rehabilitation. And in the Singapore case, we increased people finding work from 37% to 49%, and in Australia, 27% increase in people returning to work within 150 days. So really interesting that we're seeing similar types of effect sizes, sometimes even better, when we try something in the UK and then we test it in different contexts. So, now to the penultimate section. Well, this is to test you all awake and see if you've been listening. We're going to run through one case study and ask you to guess which you think the most effective arm is. Owain and Max have both talked about the importance of randomized evaluations to test what actually works in practice. So, Bob Giardini already alluded to this, he stole our punchline, but that's fine, we'll continue with it anyway. And the idea here was, how could we get people to sign up to our organ donation register through our DVLA website? So we get huge traffic to this site when people reapply for their tax disc every year, 12 million a year, around 1 million people a month go through this, so a very high volume site. And when you went onto that site, you were randomly selected to receive one of 8 messages. I'm just going to talk you through very quickly what those 8 messages are. Can anyone remember what the most effective message was from Bob Giardini's talk?
Would you like an organ donation?
Perfect, yes, so reciprocity. So you will see that that was the most effective message. So we know that's the most effective, so I'm actually going to ask you to guess what the second most effective message was. The principle still stands. So the control group, it just said, thank you, please join the organ donor register. The second arm included a social norm. So every day, thousands of people who see this page decide to register. The third arm used this norm and reinforced it with the image of a group of people. The fourth arm did the same, but used the organ donation logo. The fifth arm used a sort of lost frame message that highlighted that 3 people die every day because there are not enough organ donors. The sixth arm split that on its head and had a game frame message. It said, you could save or transform up to 9 lives as an organ donor. The seventh, Bob Giardini, the most successful one, reciprocity. And the final one, we know that most people support organ donation, so in this case we would try to translate that into action. If you support organ donation, please turn your support into action. Okay, so we've got the social norms, social norm with a picture, social norm with a logo, loss frames, game frames, reciprocity, and action. Okay, so quick show of hands, yeah?
Do you just select the options, or do you do any kind of focus groups before you run the big trials?
Yeah, great question. So it will depend by the interventions. In some interventions, particularly, so for example, with the job centre, you will come up with a bundle of interventions and then spend time with the staff and with the end users to see what you think will be most effective, but also from your understanding of the literature. So actually things like the commitment device or the implementation intention, you've seen that booklet, actually most staff and job seeker advisors weren't really sure about that. Really interesting, both the UK and Singapore, the advisor said, people will never use this. They'll never fit it in, they'll lose the booklet. We'll have to photocopy everything, it'll be a nightmare administratively. In both cases, less than a handful of people ever lost that booklet. Okay, so we knew from the literature that implementation intentions and commitment contracts could be very powerful, and we had to then design it in a way which we thought would be most effective. And we used those discussions to work out what would be most effective.
Yeah. I mean, in some ways,
what you're now about to do is imagine that you're a focus group and you can see which one of these messages is likely to be most effective, and we can see what the difference between the perception of what's going to work and the reality in practice might be. I mean, you might get it completely right, but there might be some nuances within it.
Exactly. So as I was saying, we will sometimes do focus group, we'll have discussions with our end users, and sometimes we will do that with our academic advisors as well. And then we'll run the trials, find out. So let's run that experiment now. So number one, if you could just put your hands up if you think the control message is the most effective. Probably quite unlikely I'd be using this example if that was the case.
You mean second most effective?
The second most effective, yes, thank you, Max. Good qualification. I'm Cialdini. So yes, the second most effective message. So hands up who thinks number two, the social norm, would be the second most effective. No? Okay. On number three, the norm with the image of the group of people. A few of you, handful of you, yeah, half a dozen or so, yeah. Okay, a few late joiners to that group, okay. Social norms in action there, just so a few more hands go up, the rest of you decide to creep there. Okay, number four, social norm with the organisation logo. Just a couple of you, okay. On number five, the lost range. Similar sort of number there, a dozen of you. So the game frames, the nine lives. Okay, great. The most popular there by quite some distance. The reciprocity, you know that Bob Giglini's taking my punchline, but there you go. And the final one, action. A small number of you. Okay, so let's have a look at the results. So effectively there, we've done what you just asked. We spoke to a group of people, and they told us what they thought would be most effective. Okay, so you could just then say, well, we'll pick the favorite one. In this case, the lost frame message, three die, we'll just roll that. Okay. But actually, the reason you do that is to draw on the evidence for what looks like it might work, test that, but then actually run a proper experiment in action, and this is what the results told us. So you can see there, the action, 2.8%, you get a bit of a bump. The social norm goes up to 2.9%, along with the logo and the nine lives. So, you know, good guess. The majority of you there got sort of midway through, so a good attempt, actually pretty effective. The answer we were looking for here, the three die, the loss range, was actually the second most effective. As Bob pointed out, the most effective drew on reciprocity. But very interestingly for us, the social norm with the group of people actually had a negative impact. Okay? And again, afterwards it's easy to come up with hypothesis as to why that might be. In this case, you know, the leading hypothesis is actually the image didn't really resonate with users because it neither looked like a group of people who needed an organ or were about to donate an organ. It looked like a stock image, in fact. And it's very easy after the event to come up with those sort of hypothesis and explanations, but before, it's actually quite difficult to do. So actually, the need to run randomized controls is very, very acute. Okay, so we're now going to move into the final part of the session, which is a world first. This could go horribly wrong, but let's see. We're going to do a live brainstorm, which is going to be based around some cards that you will all be receiving tomorrow. The East cards, which Owain's just going to talk through how that's going to work, and I'm going to come out magician style into the audience to look for some audience participation in terms of selecting.
We've got a bit of time for some questions now. We've also got some time right at the end for some questions. So before we go into the world first, if anyone's got any questions, yeah,
Joseph. The question about the scarcity.
Yeah.
Where do you put that in the easy framework?
So it kind of depends exactly what you mean by scarcity.
Can you
so,
repeat the question?
Where does scarcity fit into the easy framework? So I think there are two different ways of thinking about scarcity within the field of behavioral science. So there's a scarcity which is in the sense of, for example, you've only got so much time in order to fulfill this particular obligation, and you better do it now, otherwise you'll miss that opportunity. And that would be within the attractive side of the ease framework. I actually think that the kind of Shafir and Miller-Layton scarcity hypothesis, which Elder Shafir taught us through this morning, it kind of goes across the whole of the East framework and is a sort of precursor to it. And the real thing about the East framework is, how can you draw on the insight that the scarcity hypothesis might lead you to start developing solutions to the problems that you might face along the way? So two different ways of sort of thinking about scarcity. Do we have another question before we go into...
Yeah, you've shown a lot of insights
that nudging works, and that often has been implemented, as far as I know, in different contexts. But Max, you showed us the experiment with signing the text form. As far as I know, this has not been implemented yet. Why not? Who are the groups who are most resistant?
So the good news is that it has been implemented. So within the paper that we published, we talked about an insurance company who moved the signature from the bottom to the top. In the US, people report their odometer. And if you drive more miles, you pay a bigger premium, so people lie. And we showed a pretty amazing effect by moving the signature. In 2 weeks, the US government will be releasing a study on fee payment by corporations. And they, on a fairly small population, they've collected an extra $1.6 million that they're quite happy about, but they think they can multiply by a factor of about 100. We're optimistic that we know about a tax collection study that's been performed that the results look small but very good. And that is sort of Owain and Rory suggested, sometimes a small percentage increase can mean a lot of money. I'm not at liberty to talk about that study. But I would also say that I've talked to the US Internal Revenue Service, and they tell me they don't have the budget to do the IT work, which is totally ridiculous, because the magnitude of the potential money that would be gained is quite enormous. So you run into barriers. In the US, we don't have the track record of success within the government of using these kinds of experiments. And lots of agencies are far more resistant than I would like. But we keep working at it. So I fully predict that a decade from now, we will have moved the signature on lots of forms, because so far there's no bad results, and it looks like there's some pretty wonderful results that emerge. But a lot of things just take time. So most of the things that we hear Rory and Owain talking about as successes, there's some social psychologists who will tell you, we knew that 20 years ago. Okay, but we didn't implement it. And I think that what's amazing about what's going on in the last 5 years is sort of based on the nudge ideas and the successes in the behavioral insight team, we see this kind of pivot in the implementation. So you're looking at it, why haven't things been implemented now? And my reaction is, in comparison to where we were 5-10 years ago, what I see going on is astounding, and I'm delighted.
And I think there's something really important about what you were suggesting, Max, in terms of the implementation side of things. What Rory was saying earlier in terms of co-design, is very often we find that it's easy to come up with an idea, it's hard to build the support for rolling it out and doing things in a different way. And what's crucial, kind of goes to the heart of our explore phase as well, is building relationships with people who are prepared to do things differently. The guy that Rory mentioned who was behind our first tax trials, Nick Down, he is he's not an amazingly senior person in HMRC, but he was somebody who was prepared and interested in doing things differently. And it's only as a consequence of having officials within governments who are prepared to think of it differently that you can make these sorts of things happen. But once you've got a few people to do that, there is a kind of social norming aspect to it as well, that it becomes easier to then take the next step. And I think Max is absolutely right, that in the next few years we will start to see some of these more interesting examples take off. For us in the UK, I think that time will be at the point where we start transitioning from mainly paper-based forms to online forms. And there's something interesting, I think, about the extent to which we could use these prompts at the right moments to encourage more honest behaviours in the online environment as well as on paper-based forms.
Just one additional point is, as David and Jeremy talked about, there's sort of almost two elements of online. There's the sort of behavioural science part of it, and then there's the sort of experimental side of it, and the growth of these work centres. And actually, it will be those that really transform and spread through the sector. So if you think about something like the education example, the text message, that could get great results, but how do we spread that throughout the system? How do we influence governing boards and head teachers to actually take that on? And if you have a look at the Education Endowment Foundation's website, you'll see some of the work that they're doing, which is fantastic in terms of running hundreds of RCTs across schools now, but also then collating that evidence and giving it back to head teachers and governing boards in an accessible format so they can understand, sort of bang for your buck, what are the best approaches to take. And actually that's a really important part of the process that you can actually use some of the behavioural insights on, is once you've got a trial result, how do you then spread that through a sector? I think that's a really big focus as well.
Should we take one or two more questions, then we'll go into the world premiere of the East Coast. There's a question at the back.
Thanks very much for a series of very powerful presentations. My question is about unintended consequences of an intervention, or where you actually see the opposite behaviour from the one that you intended. I mean, I'm sure everybody's got their theory about why the group of people actually reduced compliance. Personally, it might have been invoking some sort of diffusion of responsibility effect, and maybe a single face, or maybe a single face of somebody not looking too well and possibly needing a transplant might have been more powerful. But I'm just thinking as well of recently going down the M1. There are clearly some sort of, I don't know if it's still the case, but there's some sort of experiment going on in presenting road signs in different formats. And that's a really interesting field for experimentation and research, South Kensington, and all of that. My own reaction to it, and maybe it's the curse of knowledge, was to just roll my eyes a bit at seeing, you know, the sort of, there was a great loss of authority, but what the signs gained in sort of informality and maybe trying to be more engaging, they lost authority in the process of doing so, and kind of made me feel a bit alienated. I didn't drive any faster, I just like to say, I stayed within the speed limit. However, yeah, it was not getting the entire intended consequence. And I just wondered whether you had more experience or thoughts about what causes that.
So I'd say two things. The first is that is why we test and trial things, because sometimes policy can have unintended consequences. I think our assumption would be that very often policies that we're putting in place have unintended consequences. It's just that we don't know it because we're not actually testing and trialing to find out what's working, what's not working. The second is that I think we do see this in lots and lots of different areas, but it will depend often on the different policies. So we've given a couple of examples. What we didn't do, but there are many examples of in our update report, is to show some examples of things that haven't worked. Increasingly, I think it's really, really important for us in our publications to say, here's something that worked, here's something that didn't work. So don't do the thing that didn't work, start doing more of the things that did work. But some famous examples of so-called rebound effects. It is quite common when introducing energy efficiency programs for people to respond by making their homes more energy efficient and then turning the heat up, wandering around in their pants. Underwear for the Americans in the audience. So that the impact of your energy efficiency measures don't actually result in people saving as much energy as they might think. An example from a similar area, in our update report, so we did a lot of work with the Department of Energy and Climate Change and Newcastle City Council around using boiler engineers to help to show people how to use their heating controls, to do things like turn off radiators in rooms that were being underused, to program their thermostats. It had no impact at all. So it's not just about rebound effects, where you get perverse results. It's also about when things just don't work in the way that you might imagine. I go back to my first point, which is, this is why we test and trial, so that we can do more of the things that do work and fewer of the things that don't.
I'll tell you, Dan, my sort of two points would be, the example you cite around authority and some of the sort of difference of tone there, we actually saw an example of that in Singapore, where they had a sort of traditionally compliance-focused letter, and then they wanted to try to develop a sort of comic strip effect around trying to encourage these SMEs to take up life insurance, and that actually did have a rebound effect. And you know, there is increasing evidence that if it seemed to be too gimmicky or not to have that authority, you can lose some of that effect. But an additional point, I think, is also the amount of time and effort you would go into trying to understand and to make allowance of that would vary depending on your intervention. So if you're sending out a tax letter, often the worst that would happen would be that you don't get any additional revenue. Basically, there's no extra cost. Some of the work that I'm doing in Australia at the minute is around domestic violence. Now, if you get that wrong, the consequences are severe, they are profound, they can potentially be fatal. So the amount of prep work that you would go in, and the amount of time you would spend thinking about any possible unintended consequences and how you might measure and get early signs of that, would be of an order of magnitude different to if you were changing effects. Mm. So it's really important to think through the nature of the intervention and then how you would look for and measure those effects.
And just one last point before, and then we'll have more questions here, but we'll go into the brainstorm, which is the, and it kind of relates to the question that somebody asked earlier, which is that we are increasingly, especially when it's a kind of larger scale intervention, testing iterations of the intervention in online experiment platforms to see whether or not something might work, which we find is more effective than using focus group type approaches, because often people don't necessarily know what is likely to be most effective if you ask them what they think will be most effective. And then one last point of the gentleman in the back made in terms of the effect of the picture group of people versus an individual. There is a lot of evidence from the charitable giving research that shows that if you focus on an individual that a charity is helping, that's much more powerful than focusing on the effect of the charity overall. So you might find that if you're getting some literature from Oxfam, for example, they will talk about the child, they will name that child, they will say how they have helped that child, in contrast to saying we're helping millions of children across the world every year, which, if you think about it, you might think is likely to be more effective. Your money is going to a charity that's helping millions of people, but actually, often it's not. It's more effective to focus on the individual, the story that goes behind that. Right, so on to the live brainstorm. So the reason we wanted to do this is that we have developed a set of cards that apply the East framework to a set of cards that you can use for your own brainstorming. We're going to give you a pack of those tomorrow in one of the plenary sessions. But we just thought we'd give you a little bit of a run through of how this can work in practice. And as Rory said, this could go horribly wrong. So be patient with us. And we'll actually ask you at various points to help us as well. So we're all in this together. As one chance within the checker once said. The way this is going to work is you will have a degree of responsibility in this. You will vote on one of the three topical policy issues that we're about to introduce. Three of you will be chosen to pick an East card from the pack that my glamorous assistant, Dr. Rory Gallagher, will be coming around with. And this is what they look like. Each of them covers a different behavioural insight, a different behavioural effect. So here are a few examples. Mental accounting, a network nudge, which is basically using the power of social networks to have an effect, or the foot in the door technique. And then Rory and I, possibly with the support of Max, if he's willing to help us, but I suspect at this point he might take a bit of a backseat. That's what I would do if I were in his shoes. We'll generate some ideas that can be tested. And you should all feel free to chip in at that point too. Right, so here are the three areas. The first is, these are all big policy challenges that we're probably all facing in the governments that we work with around the world. In the UK, one in four people are obese, and there's lots of potential, we think, for the use of behavioural science to solve aspects of this particular issue. The other is something we've heard a bit about already, but we might want to get into a bit deeper, which is around job searching. Almost 2 million people still looking for work in the UK, a problem that governments around the world are almost constantly grappling with. And then the third, again, something we've spoken about a bit, but could talk about a lot more, household energy efficiency. Households account for about 25% of UK carbon emissions, and that's reasonably typical for countries around the world. So we're going to vote on which one of these three topics we want to live brainstorm around. We're going to do that by, I'm not sure this is going to work, but let's give it a go. We're going to do this by clapping and whooping and hollering. And then Rory and I are going to judge how much noise is created for each different topic. Right? So we've got obesity, job searching, and energy efficiency. And I think we're prepared to accept that if there's a particularly loud person who really likes one topic, fine, we're just going to go with that. Okay, so make lots and lots of noise if you want us to live brainstorm obesity. I didn't think you were going to go with that, but you did. Okay, what about job searching?
That's
right. Okay. I'm now glad.
I'm not sure between
those two. One of the cards is ordering effects. The effect of the order in which information is presented. I'm very glad that job searching wasn't the first one that we went with. So I just assumed that it wasn't going to work. And lastly, energy efficiency! It's tough. Okay, I'm not sure whether it's obesity or energy efficiency. Let's just try that again. Okay, I think it's definitely obesity. Right, so Dr. Rory Gallagher is going to go through the audience. And if you put your hands up if you want to participate, you don't have to do anything more than pick out a card. And Rory will come to you and then he'll read out the East card that has been selected. So if you want to, does anybody want to have a go? Yes?
Thank you.
Lots
of
you.
Excellent. What's your name?
Lily.
Lily. Excellent. And what's on your card?
Personalized.
Personalization. Excellent. So the first card is personalization. Who's next? Yes, sir. Excellent. My name is
Andreas.
Cool.
And commitment contracts.
Commitment contracts. Okay, excellent. Personalization and commitment contracts. And one more.
And it's anchoring.
Anchoring. Excellent. Okay, so the three are Owain, personalization, commitment contracts, and anchoring.
Okay. So we're going to now use these cards to generate a few ideas. Where should we start, Rory? Should we start with anchoring? Or do you want to go straight into commitment contracts?
Should we go in the order of the cards? Let's start with personalization.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we've heard a bit about personalization already. We know that basically putting in place any kind of scheme, any kind of service, or indeed something that you might be trying to do yourself is much, much more effective if you focus on the individual. And you can do this in all kinds of areas.
And so in this field of obesity, this has been a really interesting sort of set of elements technologically over the last few years. If you think about Fitbits, they are great at giving you personalized real-time feedback on your movement. And actually that is leading to a step change in the way that people move, particularly at work and around the office. And we've seen all sorts of ways that is increasing people's use, particularly where they are compared to others in their immediate environment or in their peer group. But that sort of real-time feedback is really, really important. And actually the ways that we're seeing that develop, for example, the Fitbit's buzzing when you haven't moved for a particular time is actually very important. And to sort of slightly jump ahead to the anchoring point, the sort of this growing narrative around 10,000 steps per day is actually quite effective at giving people that target to focus on. One of the interesting things that we're starting to see in sort of Cass's work, one of Max's colleagues, is whether you can use personalized defaults or personalized targets. So actually, for example, what is most effective, one of the things we're actually starting to test in Australia is, should you use that sort of standard target of 10,000, or actually is it more effective to look at people's baseline and the sort of group they're in, and then set a personalized target based on that, and then give people a series of plans and actions about how they might reach
that. And I think what Rory said about the personal relating to the social is really important here. And so when we think about personalization, we often think about it just in relation to an individual, but it can often be much more powerful to set that individualization in a broader context. So the kind of stuff that we've been talking about a lot in relation to social norms is completely relevant here. Sometimes knowing what you are doing and knowing what you are doing in relation to a specific goal can be very, very powerful. But knowing what you're doing in relation to a specific goal in the context of knowing what other people around you are doing, especially people who are more like yourself, is even more powerful. So the personal and the social become intimately connected. The other thing that we're always talking about, which is really important, is the extent to which you're given feedback about the progress that you're making in relation to that personal goal. So in this case, it could be around the amount of physical exercise that you undertake. We actually know that in most of the obesity research, physical exercise is important, but it is nothing compared to calorific consumption. So it might be around the kind of food that you eat. But just as an aside, one of the things, and this is kind of goes back to the heart of making it easy, one of the things that we also know is that people find it very, very difficult to do things like monitoring their calorific intake. And a lot of the recent research around heuristics, for example, is showing that simple rules of thumb seem to work better than more complex kinds of calorie counting when we're thinking about what we can do at a personal level for the individual.
If I apply that to my own behaviour, so...
dangerous.
It's very dangerous. So I got married in September last year, and both me and my wife decided we're going to try and get fit for the big day. And we tried various different techniques, most of which were an absolute failure. One that seemed to be most effective actually when we started the 5-2 diet. And again, partly due to the reason that Owain just talked about, and this sort of anchoring around, actually trying to work out what your daily calorie intake is extremely hard. And that cognitive effort required every day to sort of mentally calculate that and to keep making healthier decisions was actually very, very difficult. But a simple rule of thumb where on 2 days you had a very strict calorie intake and on the other 5 days you could do what you want was actually extremely powerful. And so we're starting to see, are there other types of these anchors or simple rules of thumb that you can use that allow people to create these simple sort of heuristics and rules of thumb which are much more effective at driving behavior?
And Baumeister calls these bright lines, things that make it really clear when you're stepping over the line. But we are in danger of stepping over another line, which is going to other East cards rather than focusing on the ones that you have selected. So should we talk a bit about commitment contracts?
Yeah, great. So one of the places, we already talked about this in the relation to the job centre work, actually people writing down what it is that they're going to do and committing to their advisor what it is they're going to do. We've actually seen that this can easily be applied also to obesity. Again, to draw on a personal example, as I want to do. Actually, when I was in, you can see my constant struggles to get fit in this. I worked with Owain back in the UK before I moved over to Australia. And again, one of my attempts to exercise more was to get membership of the gym at work. And again, I found that despite signing up and paying money for this, my use of it was very, very limited. Despite the fact every week, I would genuinely believe that week I would use it and take my kit in again and then take it home at the end of the week again when I hadn't used it. And so I used a simple commitment contract where, just behind where we used to work, I wrote up on the whiteboard, I, Rory Gallagher, will exercise once a week, every week, for 3 months in the Treasury gym, and if I don't, I will buy and wear a Robin Van Persie shirt into the office. I'm a Tottenham Hotspur fan, Robin Van Persie at the time, played for Arsenal, which is our rival team, that Owain supports, before he moved on to Brighter Lights at Manchester United.
Before he became a traitor, I think.
And for me, that was really, really effective. The sense that I publicly committed to doing this rather than just to myself. And again, you can apply this to your own life if you think about things like New Year's resolutions. You know, most of them are over by the sort of second week of January. If you want to take that same principle, rather than just saying to yourself, I'm going to give up chocolate or I'm going to move more, actually, if you make a very specific contract, make it public, and think of what the consequence of not doing that would be, you're actually much more likely to follow through.
And there's something interesting about Rory's example, despite, you know, summoning up images of favourite football players going to rival clubs. And that's that a lot of people think, when they're thinking about setting commitment contracts, they think about financial penalties or financial rewards that you might benefit from if you achieve your goal or you fail to achieve your goal. But a lot of the research shows that the intrinsic rewards are more powerful. So in this case, I think you'd have had to put aside a lot of money to be as powerful a motivator for Rory as wearing the football shirt of a rival team. And that's often the case in lots and lots of different areas. Should we just quickly talk about
Andrew?
Rory, yeah. Before touching, yeah. Did you unfailingly go to the gym every week?
Yes, I did. And that was the beauty of this example. I should have said I did, but only because of that consequence and the public nature and the stirring on from my colleagues.
And you didn't lie about just a little bit 1 week and you had a bit of
The great thing, so this is a really important point, is how publicly accountable can you be? The great thing about this was the gym was at work. So people could see that when I would go and do it, as opposed to me saying, I run on the beach. I wouldn't do that back in London. You know, it's something that no one could actually see.
But it raises a really important point, which is that there are four or five different ways of strengthening your commitment contract, and one of them is having a credible referee, so somebody who is really likely to enforce the commitment contract if you transgress. In Ayres, who's written this great book, Carrots and Sticks, says that that referee shouldn't be somebody who is too close to you. If, for example, your wife or your husband is the enforcer of your commitment contract, they may well allow you to transgress, because you know they might you might be an exception. But you need a credible referee to enforce a commitment contract, or rather, it is more likely that you will fulfil that contract if you do have a credible referee.
And actually, Inez, who wrote the book that I referred to, actually has a website, if you want to find it, it's called stick.com, where you make exactly those types of commitments. Ironically, it's seen a surge in donations to the George Bush Foundation and National Rifle Association for people who thought that would be a horrible consequence to donate money and then never didn't follow through on their good intention, but ended up donating to people that they weren't in support of. And so just one more example that I think heroically and probably errorfully tries to draw these areas together. It's a trial that we're running actually at the moment in New South Wales, which tries to take some of the principles of each of these elements and apply it at scale to overweight and obese kids. So we know that things like personal trainers are pretty effective because they give you that personalised feedback and set your personalised plan. Obviously those often on low income can't afford those sorts of services. So the question was, could we use some of those principles and take it to scale? Where people got personalised advice and support around their sort of weight loss and then set a bunch of plans in place, set out a set of measures that can to then follow for a period. So we actually worked with a program, it was a 10-week program, where kids and their parents came together once a week to be giving information and simple rules of thumb about eating more healthily and exercising more. And then on top of that, rather than just sort of giving the information, we put in place a series of commitment contracts about what these kids and parents were going to do. And the really important thing about this was that parents were involved as well. Because we know, actually, that what an influence they have on their kids' intake, about 74% of kids' intake will be through their family home and through what they are cooked for breakfast and dinner. And so actually bringing them into the picture was really important. And then post-programme, once they've made those goals, we sent them text messages every week for the following months to try and remind them of those goals. Now, we don't know the result of that yet, but you can see that as an attempt to provide people with personalised plans around how they can introduce that, set up a series of commitments around how they're going to do it and anchor them on particular targets, which we are hoping will see a significant impact. And again, we should see those results towards the end of this year, so we'll be publishing them in November.
So you've been so successful in helping us to perform this world-exclusive live brainstorm, and we're now out of time. So we don't have any time for questions, but what we'll do is we'll stay behind for a bit and maybe have a bit of a conversation about some of these things if you have got any questions. But thank you for your time.